In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy and gracious God, I confess that I have sinned against you. Some of my sin I know, the thoughts, words, and deeds of which I am ashamed, but some is known only to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask for forgiveness. Deliver and restore me, that I may rest in peace. By the mercy of God, we are united with Jesus Christ, and in him we are forgiven. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O God, the strength of those who hope in you, be present in your prayers, and because of the weakness of our mortal nature, we can do nothing without you. Give us the help of your grace, so that in keeping your commandments, we may please you in will and deed, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to worship. Please indicate your presence here today one of two ways. In the pew rack in front of you, you'll see a card that says, "We're glad you're here." Please fill out that information and put it in either offering basket on the end of your pew or use the QR code on the back of the bulletin. Welcome once again to God's house. A great breakfast awaits you and fellowship following the service today in the Family Life Center all summer long. We hope that you'll take part in that opportunity. At 12:15 today here in the sanctuary, we'll be having our semi-annual meeting. It's a very short meeting, a very important meeting. So please come back to that as we'll be electing council and officers. 12:15 today here in the sanctuary. You'll notice in the announcements that throughout the summer there's various opportunities for some barbecue. What a perfect time to have barbecue in the summer, huh? Notice how you can gather with other folks of the congregation and community. The first one is going to be on July 10th at the feed store. Please note the details. On the 10th of July, we're going to be having another opportunity for you to update your picture for our pictorial directory online. Of course, there's no charge for that, but we hope that you'll take advantage of that. That's in between the services. It'll be in the conference room down the hall. So please plan on that on July 10th to have your picture updated. Commend to you the rest of the announcements. We continue now with the anthem for the morning. Thank you.
The reading is from 1 John, and we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. The Lord is gracious and merciful. The Lord is good to all. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord.
Thank you.
according to St. Luke, the 9th chapter.
Glory.
When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. But they did not receive him, because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." Jesus said to him, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The Gospel of the Christ. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Would you open your Bibles, please, with me for our study today to the book of 1 John. We're going to study out of the fourth chapter. If you're using a Pew edition of Holy Scripture, you'll find that on page 213 in the New Testament. 1 John, the fourth chapter, for our study today. Does God ever have a bad day? Does God ever have a bad day? Are there those things that impinge on his feelings to where he says, it's just a bad day today? Does God ever get cranky? Does God ever get cranky? Is God ever in a mood? Is God ever in a mood? Does he have mood swings? We continue our study today. All summer long, we are taking a look at a different attribute of God. Sunday after Sunday, a different attribute all throughout the summer. We've studied so far the aseity of God. That's God's self-existence. God is independent. He's self-sufficient. We studied last week about the immutability of God. That's the attribute that God does not change. He cannot change. Well, today I'd like to take a look at the emotions of God. The emotions of God. And we're going to take a look at an attribute that's called impassibility. The impassibility of God. To do so, we're going to study out of 1 John, the fourth chapter. It's going to take me just a little bit to get there, however, but I think you'll understand why. The other day I was late for an appointment, and I had those lights timed perfectly that every light was red. I found myself thinking, can't somebody coordinate these kind of things? Where, you know, if you get in that kind of stretch, you're just not stuck in it for a while. Can somebody kind of coordinate and give a little variance to it? And when I would come to a red light, I'd be frustrated inside. I was stressed. I was late. Red light after red light after red light, frustration and stress building as I went along, and it wasn't until I got closer to my destination that I picked up a few green lights. The red light invoked frustration, stress. The green light invoked happiness. When I'd get another red light, the stress would return, the occasional green, happiness. See, the red lights and the green lights, they influenced my emotions. Red, frustration, green, and happiness. That's what's called passibility. Passibility. When those things from the outside influence us and it affects our emotions. That's passibility. Let me give you another example. The children's book entitled Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day. Remember what happened to poor Alexander on that day? He went to bed with gum in his mouth. Never a good idea, right? Woke up with gum in his hair. He tripped over his skateboard. He dropped his sweater underneath the running water. He got to school, and Paul told him that he was no longer his best friend. In fact, he was now his third best friend. On and on the story goes. Alexander's terrible, horrible, very bad day. See the gum and the skateboard and dropping of the sweater and what Paul told him when he got to school, and on goes the list. It all impacted how he felt emotionally. Alexander was passable. In fact, all of us have the attribute of passability. All of us. Where that from the outside influences our emotions. God is impassible. That's a negation, isn't it, of passibility. God is not affected by that which comes from the outside of himself. Put it another way. God does not change emotionally in response to his creation. He doesn't change emotionally in response to his creation. But now, wait a minute here. Wait a minute. Because it certainly seems, as we read the account of Scripture, that there are those things that are influencing and changing the emotions of God, doesn't it? I think, for example, of Psalm 78. How often they rebelled against him in the wilderness and grieved him in the desert. It sure seems as if that which is occurring outside of God is impacting him and causing the emotion of grief, right? It was the disobedience of the people. Or we read about the anger of God. Moses says in Deuteronomy 1, even with me the Lord was angry on your account, saying, you also shall not enter there. The anger of God. We read 1 Kings, the 3rd chapter. It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. Well, what pleased the Lord? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked for wisdom. Sure seems as if the emotions of God are influenced by that which is outside, Solomon asking for wisdom, which invoked then the pleasure of God, doesn't it? Or Zephaniah 3, he will rejoice over you with gladness. Well, that is a small sampling of where it seems like that which is outside of God is influencing, causing his emotions. So how is it that we can say that God is impassible? Because this has been an attribute of God that has been taught in the church for centuries. How is it then that we can say that God is impassible? Now we're ready for 1 John. 1 John, let's start in verse 14 of chapter 4. John writes this, and we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. Verse 10 is a related verse. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Remember, that's such a key word, atonement. Remember, it's an easy word to remember the meaning. You just break down atonement into at-one-ment. That's what God effects for us through the Lord Jesus Christ. We are separated by God from God because of sin. Through the Lord Jesus Christ, that relationship is restored. The Lord Jesus bears all of our sin on the cross. God's just wrath for sin is laid upon the Savior. all of our sin covered through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, the sacrifice for sin accepted. We see it so clearly in the resurrection. God's validation that the sacrifice for sin indeed was accepted. And what's the result? We are brought back into relationship with God. We are forgiven. God calls us his own in the waters of baptism. At one-ment, the love of God expressed in the atonement. Look now, please, at verse 15. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. You see, when we are brought to faith, the Holy Spirit takes residence in us. Next verse, verse 16. So we've known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love. God is love. Now you can't reverse that. You can't say, love is God. No, God is love. What does that mean? God is not moved to love. There is nothing outside of God that moves him to be loving. No, God is love. He's not moved to be loving. He is love. Put it this way. God does not fall in love. God doesn't grow in love. Love doesn't mature in God. God doesn't fall in love. We can fall in love, right? We can fall in love. We can grow in love. Love can mature. But God doesn't fall in love. Why? Because he is love. Love in perfection. Love in constancy. He doesn't fall into it. He is love. Put it this way. God does not fall in love with us because he finds something attractive in us. In other words, God never says, you know, I really enjoyed being with that person. He doesn't then move on to say, no, I think I like that person. He doesn't then say, you know, I like you. He then doesn't say, oh, I think I might be falling in love with that person. And then he doesn't say, well, I'm now in love with you. There's nothing attractive in us to where God is drawn to us and God then falls in love with us because we are so lovable and so attractive to God. No, God simply loves. There's nothing outside of him that makes him love. Why? Because God is love. He's not affected in his emotions from the outside. God does not change emotionally based upon a response to his creation. The impassibility of God. Now ponder that a little bit. Ponder that in relationship with all of God's emotions. his impassibility. Ponder that a little bit. As an example, I think of a very, very effective advertisement, I think. Perhaps you've seen it. It's an advertisement from an organization that cares for animals. And they, as a part of the advertisement, they show pictures of animals who are suffering. Maybe it's been because they've been abused or neglected, or they're hungry, or they're cold. Now, why is the advertisement geared that way? Why are so many pictures of animals suffering and a pan in to many of their eyes? Why is that? Because the organization wants to move us to mercy, right? So that, in this case, there would be a financial contribution to the organization so that they can continue and further their work of caring for these hurting animals. That advertisement is effective because it moves to mercy. As human beings, we have to be moved to mercy. We have to be moved to mercy. We are in no way consistent in the expression of mercy. We are in no way perfect in the expression of mercy. To be merciful as human beings, we have to be moved to mercy. So the situation outside of us then moves us to mercy. Humans have to be moved to mercy. God doesn't have to be moved to mercy. In other words, God doesn't look at situations and say, oh, the terrible situation that is going on, I am now moved to mercy because of the situation that is going on. No, God doesn't have to be moved to mercy. Why? Because God is mercy. He is mercy. God doesn't have to be moved to hate injustice. He doesn't have to be moved to hate injustice. God doesn't look at a situation and say, that situation, why, that moves me to hate that particular injustice. No. God hates injustice. God doesn't have to be moved to grieve over sin. God doesn't look down from his throne and sees a situation of sin. And he doesn't have to be moved by that situation to grieve over the sin and its impact on the person and perhaps those around the person. God doesn't have to be moved to grieve. No, God is the one who grieves sin. And so God is not moved to anger. He's not moved to joy. He's not moved to grief over sin. He's not moved to anger over injustice. On and on down the list. No, when God expresses his joy, when God expresses his anger, when God expresses his grief over sin, that's not because he's been moved, it's simply God being God. Because it's who he is. How different that is from us humans. How different that is. Because we're moved from the outside. And God simply expresses his perfect emotions in a perpetual, perfect, constant state so that when God expresses his joy, his anger, his grief, etc., It's not because he's been moved to that. It's because who he is. Who he is. So does God ever have a bad day? Is God ever cranky? Is God ever just in a mood? And has all kinds of mood swings? No, no, and no. Because remember, God is immutable. He doesn't change. He can't change. He's God. And because he can't change, therefore, he must be impassible, which means his emotions cannot change. Now, why is that important? Because if we could change and influence God's emotions, if we could change and influence God's emotions, then there would be no assurance of the constancy of his love and his grace and his mercy. If God's emotionally influenced by the outside, if his emotions can change in response to his creation, no assurance of his grace, his love, and his mercy. The impassibility of God. How blessed we are that God is not like us humans. And that makes me really happy. You too? Let's rise and confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please remain standing.
Thank you.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Holy God, we praise you for the attribute of your impassibility. We praise you that your emotions are unchangeable, constant, and perfect. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious Lord, we thank you for your steadfast love and for calling us to follow you. Fill us with your Spirit so that we may live fruitful lives in all things. Help us glorify you and nourish those who are starving for your good word. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Spirit of truth, we pray for the people and mission of this congregation. Guide us that we may keep focused on doing your will. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
God of healing and comfort, be with all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. We pray especially for Debbie Weems, Carol Dixon, Andy Sizemore, Liz Rake, Bryce Perkins, Paige and Linda Creech, the family of Laura Smith, the family of Mike Williams, Burl Gilliam, Mia Rodriguez, Don Papendorf, Phineas Traxler. Hear now the prayers we hold on our lips and in our hearts.
Into your hands, Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your goodness and mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, our Lord took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You are all invited to this table of grace. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ now strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. And we pray that in your mercy you would strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you of his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Amen.